Adventures in Spirit and Entrepreneurship, podcast episode number 39.
Welcome to Adventures in Spirit and Entrepreneurship podcast. Interviews with amazing spiritual teachers and successful entrepreneurs 2 days a week. We want to help you free your mind and conquer your fears so you can achieve your vision of success, as well as give you practical steps on how to get there. Here is your host, Natasha Senkovich.
I'm thrilled to welcome Dr. Cynthia Foster, who received her medical degree from the University of Texas, but shifted her focus entirely toward healing with natural methods after healing herself from an incurable disease. Also, she's the author of the popular and controversial book entitled Stop the Medicine, and she gives lectures all over the United States and Canada. Welcome, Dr. Foster.
Thank you, Natasha. It's great to be here.
It's great to have you. Cynthia and I actually met briefly. She also lives in Los Angeles prior to the interview, and we had just an amazing time. I think we spent like hours and hours just like blobbing and talking, and I picked her brain all over the place, and it was amazing. So I'm so,
I know. We have so much in common.
Yeah, we just had a great time, and I'm just so thrilled to share her and all her knowledge and all that amazing stuff that she knows with you. So anyway, let's dive right in. I know you have this great story. So, tell us a little bit more about you and your journey and how you healed yourself and found yourself in this new healing modality. And
okay, it's kind of a long story, but started when I entered into a regular medical school in Texas. And I had received a vaccine prior to my admission to medical school, which is required. It's the hepatitis B vaccine. And soon after I got that vaccine, horrible things began to happen. For example, my entire body broke out into hives.
Oh, geez.
And I had to have, you know, major steroids and adrenaline shots and things to block this severe reaction I was having to the vaccine. And not very long after, I developed epilepsy. And the epilepsy was, sometimes people don't understand that term. Epilepsy, seizures, it's convulsions. I had the full body seizures where I just would lose about 3 hours during the day. And I would wake up and not really know what happened. And then at night, I would have a seizure and not know it. Because they're full body seizures, you're not aware that they're happening. You just lose consciousness. So I was waking up with blood in my mouth where I had, you know, bitten the inside of my lips and the cheek.
Oh,
and I also was experiencing extreme pain all over my body and kind of some really extreme headaches. So I medicated myself the best I could with, you know, painkillers and things like that. And then I started to wake up every night with just a racing heartbeat, this feeling of dread. And that was probably the worst symptom I could possibly have had because no one knew that I had seizures because I wasn't aware of them. So when I went to the doctor, and granted, I was in medical school at the time. I had just started medical school. It was my first year. And I was sitting next to all these, you know, students next to me who were also learning. And the lady sitting next to me, she had just been diagnosed with something called panic disorder. Mm. And we were chatting, and I said, I've got, you know, something wrong with me. I don't know what it is, but I've got this, you know, racing heartbeat. She goes, you should go to my doctor. Because my doctor is an expert in panic disorder. He's written all these papers and he's, you know, considered one of the world's foremost experts in panic disorder. So I said, okay, great. You know, and she said, he's at the school clinic. So, you know, it'll be really easy to go. And so, you know, I made an appointment and I, you know, talked with this doctor and interestingly enough, he did not do any blood tests at all to check me for anything else. He just took my symptoms and said, yep, that's what it sounds like. So let's put you on some medication. I took the medication and it actually made things worse. I got sent to a psychiatrist who also did not know I was having seizures. And this went on for 2 years. I went to a psychiatrist and I took antidepressants, and it got to the point where I had chest pain all the time. And it did get to the point where I was waking up with my shoulder dislocated, like out of the socket.
Oh, God.
Just excruciating, excruciating pain, just like in a complete panic, like, how do I get this back in? This is just horribly painful. And so those symptoms started to become more and more obvious, to where I really had this dead on feeling something is very wrong and the doctors have not found it. Mm-hmm. So 2 years of struggling with it. Of course, I went through my entire childhood with the psychiatrist. It made no difference whatsoever in any of the symptoms. And of course, the antidepressants, which I did not know at the time, they actually lower your seizure threshold. So they can make it more likely for you to have a seizure. So everything was getting worse and worse and worse. And so at that point, I thought, and I've always been this way, if there's a problem I have, I will research, or I'll read a book, or I'll, you know, talk to people, or I'll find an answer somehow. And so my answer at that time was to read books, go to health food stores, or try to find something outside of the practice of medicine, because it was very obvious to me that they were not finding the answer. I went to several more doctors after that, all of whom just kind of patted me on the head. They were all male doctors, by the way. They all patted me on the head and just said, well, look, you've been diagnosed with this, you know, mental thing. There's, you know, really nothing wrong with you. And so just relax. And of course, that time I was having so many seizures, I was really having difficulty speaking, understanding. I had a lot of confusion. There's something called post-ictal, you know, confusion, where after a seizure, you don't know where you are. Sometimes you don't know who you are. You know, it was very difficult to get through, you know, the training of medical school, because you have to memorize a lot of information. So I, of course, was in a panic. You know, it was like $20,000 a year just to go through 1 year of medical school, and or more. And so I was really, really invested in this. And, you know, I don't come from a rich family. So everything, you know, was really riding on, could I finish medical school and get through this? So I tried the best I could. You know, I was researching around, and I found these books written by Bernard Jensen, who basically was a holistic chiropractor who had a healing ranch in California and had healed people of various incurable diseases for, you know, 40 years or so. And the concept there was that instead of managing something, you could actually cure it. And I became quite fascinated with this concept of curing something instead of just taking a medicine to manage the symptoms.
Right.
And of course, I had to read all of those books, and he's got 50. So reading those books, and I was reading the medical books, and eventually it got to the point where I kind of call my moment of crisis, which is where a fellow medical student called me on the phone, and I didn't realize that it was the phone ringing because I was so confused. I had just, you know, I mean, I would just find myself on the floor and go, you know, what happened to the last 3 hours? And so this happened. I kind of woke up out of a seizure. The phone was ringing, and it was my friend, and I didn't realize what the sound was. I didn't understand if it was my alarm clock or if it was the doorbell or if it was, you know, something else. So, but I instinctively, you know, picked up the phone and was listening to this man talk, and then I didn't understand who he was or what I was doing, so
just
started speaking gibberish. And he didn't understand what I was saying at all. You know, I really was on the tail end of a seizure. He goes, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? You know, and finally it snapped. Like, I came out of it and I said, Well, I don't know. I don't know what happened to me. It must be some, you know, at that time, my theory was that I was hypoglycemic, that it was low blood sugar or something. And so I said, I think maybe I'm hypoglycemic. And he said, well, you know, that's not normal. Right. And I, of course, was after I really came to and understood what was going on, I hung up with him and I really was in a panic. Because at that time I was separated from my family. I, you know, had moved to a different state to go to medical school. I was living in an apartment by myself. So I had to deal with this by myself. And so I immediately hung up the phone and I just said, I really need help with this. I don't know who to turn to for this, but I need to find some sort of holistic professional because it's really my only option at this point. So as I was thumbing through the pages, I found an ad for a holistic RN. So she was a nurse and she had been doing this for, I don't know, 25 years. And she was actually healing people from incurable diseases. And that was an amazing experience for me because I actually saw her every week for about a year and a half. And I got to talk to all of the people in her waiting room. And we got to share stories and discuss, you know, what was happening with us. And so that was a very difficult time. I actually chose to stay in medical school and fight through it. Despite the fact that I had such severe fatigue, it was really difficult just to stand in the shower or even chew my food. So I did something, you know, where I would come home. I'm like, I can't stand up. I'm just so tired. I can't stand up. So I put all the medical books on the floor and I studied on the floor. And so when I started this holistic program, it was like a shift from night to day. She put me on every possible remedy, supplement, juicing. I was juicing 20 ounces of carrot, vegetable, you know, greens, beet juice every day. And I juiced so much carrot, I actually turned yellow for a short period of time. It was, yeah, it was very difficult. It became apparent that I was doing something different from my other students. And, that was the point at which I really felt the challenge from the medical profession because I was kind of doing this program and she was explaining to me how it worked. And she said, it's based on the Reams theory. She tested my urine and my saliva. And she said, you know, there are all these tests that I can do, and I can see what your liver is doing. I can see, you know, what your metabolism is doing. I can see how many toxins you have. I can see when you're unloading toxins. I can see when you're in the middle of a detox. So she was walking me through this process. I was taking, you know, probiotics, vitamins, herbs, homeopathics, tissue salts. You know, I was drinking raw goat milk. I was doing, you know, I was on a completely strict diet. I could not have anything processed. And I did go through what's called a healing crisis from time to time. So I would go through a period of a few days where I actually felt worse. And then at the end of it, as I had, you know, passed through that healing crisis, I actually got stronger. And I literally passed parasites.
Oh, gosh.
I filled the entire toilet bowl with parasites. It was very obvious what had happened, and no doctor had ever thought to test me for parasites, but they can also cause seizures. So, you know, the interesting thing about the cleansing and the detox is that you can have things you don't even know that you have until you start to go through this process of detoxifying your body. So I, of course, you know, described exactly what I saw in the bowl. And she said, these are flukes. You know, I've seen this and people do pass these on the program. And I was doing major colon cleansing. I was doing all these enemas. I was doing colonics. I was, you know, she was a huge believer in colon cleansing, which I am too. But I do it in a different way. But so we went all through the colon cleansing. I turned yellow at that point. And she at one point said, your liver is so toxic. Your liver looks like you're a drug addict. And I was laughing because I, you know, was raised in a very strict family. We, you know, Mm-hmm. I didn't drink. I didn't do drugs. I didn't, you know, I didn't do any of that. In fact, I didn't even drink coffee for the most part. So my theory was it was because of all the medications I had had throughout my life. I took multiple medications for severe allergies, asthma. I had that also as well in medical school. I was taking three kinds of inhalers. I was taking nasal steroids. I was taking, you know, pills, antihistamines, decongestants. My allergies had gotten so bad. I was taking steroid shots that lasted for 6 months in my system. I mean, I was really in the medical system. So I was really full of pharmaceuticals at
and
that point.
Do you think those that's what really overloaded your liver? That those 2 years of those treatments?
I not only had the 2 years of all of those treatments, but I had an entire lifetime of allergy treatments.
Okay.
From the age of six when I had to have allergy shots. So I was very used to being medicated. I was very used to going into the doctor's office. I gave credence to the medical profession. I trusted them. Everyone in my family, you know, if we were sick, we went to the doctor. We didn't even question it. So
here
I was in the midst of a paradigm shift. Mm-hmm. You know, where I'm like, this doesn't work anymore. And if I don't find something, I might die. So so there was doing my very intense, you know, program and hiding the supplements, you know, just showing up to medical school and putting everything in my backpack and going to the bathroom, walking into the stall and taking my supplements secretly so that nobody could see what I was doing. Because, of course, I wanted to finish medical school. So I, everything was fine until I turned yellow from all of the carrot juice.
Then you were busted.
I was busted by, a doctor. I think it was on my OB-GYN rotation. And he said, you have to get tested for hepatitis right away. You could be infectious to others. Mm. And I looked at him, I said, no, this is not hepatitis. You don't understand what's going on. I'm drinking a lot of carrot juice every day. And he goes, nope, you're getting tested. So I, you know, could not argue with him. He's, of course, was in charge and in charge of my grade and everything else. So I said, okay, I'm going to get tested for hepatitis. I was completely negative. So but he, at that point, wanted me to stop. And I, of course, was not going to stop for anyone or anything because, you know, I felt my life was in danger and I was going to continue no matter what. So every time he kind of walked up to me in the hallway, I just would turn around and walk away.
And run away.
I really tried to avoid him like the plague, and it really worked. It was a 6 week rotation, and at the near the end, he finally caught up to me and he goes, "Did you stop drinking that carrot juice?" And I just smiled at him and I said, "Yes," right? Because I just want him off my back.
Right.
Because other professors had noticed and asked me about it, and they were begging me to stop seeing this other practitioner, which was my mistake. I should not have said anything at all. But they were very concerned. They said, you know, should not waste time with quacks. You need to see a real doctor.
Oh, geez.
And it was very intimidating. It was very, very intimidating. So I, you know, going back to this this male doctor, you know, I said, yes, I quit. And he said, good, you look a lot better. I had not, you know, at all.
Yeah, so why did, I know like a carrot juice tends to have a lot of sugar as well, or lots of carrots. What was the reason that she had you in all that carrot juice?
Carrot juice is very healing. It can be a lot of carbs. She did have it in a mix with other greens. I may have done it a little differently. I do it a little differently now where I actually dilute with water. So that you don't get a sugar rush when you're juicing. So it's kind of important, but it didn't seem to affect me at that point.
Okay. So you probably needed it.
Yes. And some people know. So you really have to kind of gauge, you know, nowadays candida issues are a lot more common because of all the antibiotics. Mm. So nowadays it's a lot more important than it was. This was 20 years ago when this happened. So I did everything the way she wrote it out. I got through 4 years of medical school. I could not. In fact, I think my nickname for a while was Carrot Top. Carrot Top. Because I was yellow for so long, and I really was the odd man out in medical school. And I really did not know what to do because my seizures had really decreased. Mm-hmm. Because what I described to you was basically losing 3 hours out of every day and probably was seizing every night. Mm-hmm. And I got down to once a week. And wow. I eventually found another program. We parted ways. I parted ways with that nurse. She wanted me to continue on and take over her practice and get licensed and write prescriptions. And I did not want to do that because I had been through several sort of ethical crises where I was treating patients in the school setting where I felt like I had hurt them with medicine. And I felt very sensitive about that. And I did not want to ever hurt anyone.
Right.
So, I basically turned down the offer.
Right.
And, I withdrew myself from that whole process and I went and I moved out to California to study with some natural healers. Mm-hmm. I had done, a detox program that was pretty, even more intense than that one, where I was taking herbs all day. I was doing hydrotherapy. I was doing castor oil packs. I was juice fasting where I would, you know, consume nothing but juices for an entire month. Mm. And, I was doing this by myself, by the way. It was an extremely difficult period of time in my life. I was going through all kinds of healing crisis, just crying my eyes out sometimes. Just, you know, a very difficult process to go through by yourself.
Right.
And I got through this 2-month-long detox. And I basically just kind of, you've got some vacation during your last year of medical school. And I took that time and I just, you know, walled myself in my apartment and I did this detox program all day, every day for a month. And after the second month, I literally did not have seizures anymore.
Oh, wow.
It was really an incredible miracle, and I would not have believed it was possible except for all of the patients that I had talked to at that first clinic. I mean, I saw people with lupus, I saw people with, you know, parasites, I saw people with cancer that were being cured, and I saw a lady with Lou Gehrig's disease who was fighting it and winning, and so I had seen this and I had known it was possible, and it was one of the biggest reasons why I felt I could not continue being a regular, you know, conventional doctor, because I was kind of seeing the conventional side and I was seeing people in the hospital and I was seeing what the medicine did to them. And then on the other hand, I was seeing the same sort of patients with the same sort of problems going to the holistic nurse and they were improving. So on the one hand, they were getting worse, and on the other hand, they were improving. Right. And to me, having that unique experience of seeing like that side by side comparison, really for me, there was no comparison. I just didn't understand, you know, how to go about, you know, getting the training or you know, doing what I needed to do to actually do that as a business or, you know, as a career. So,
well, let's go back to, so the actual trigger, the cause was the vaccination. You know, that's when the problem started. Now, why do you think that was? What was in that vaccine?
There are a lot of things in vaccines that people have no idea what they are. It's kind of shocking. I went through a lot of research recently to see. I've researched the issue for a long period of time. The first wave of research I did was on the symptoms that people get. The second wave was what exactly is in this stuff. So people are getting autoimmune disorders. They are getting diabetes, type 1 diabetes. They're getting something called thrombocytopenia, which is where your clotting, your blood clotting doesn't work properly. They're getting seizures, epilepsy, exactly what I had. Severe allergic reactions, anaphylactic reactions. Of course, children are getting severe high-pitched fevers. They're ending up with encephalitis, dying, or sometimes, you know, going into autism. And so I, you know, the second wave of research was, what exactly is in this? Mm-hmm. And, you know, why are people experiencing these things? Mm-hmm. So I discovered things like insect parts, cocker spaniel cells, ferret antibodies. Ferrets, of course, are kind of like polecats. They're, there's a beef heart infusion. There's chicken embryos. There's human diploid cells. These are cells that come from aborted fetuses, actually. Some of them are cultured lines. African green monkey, which they do that because monkeys share so much in common with human beings, genetically speaking. Mm-hmm. We're about 99.99%, you know, genetically similar to monkeys and chimpanzees and things like that. So this is an experiment that they've been doing since the late 1800s when they first introduced vaccines. Mm-hmm. Those are the things they put in, but those are not the adjuvants. Adjuvants are horrible things like aluminum hydroxide, thimerosal. There's various reasons they use those adjuvants, because basically the concept of a vaccine is they have to put a virus in a live medium, and that's why they're using animals. Because you can't put a virus in a solution and inject it in, the virus will die. So they have to keep it alive somehow. So they're using animal cells to do that. When you inject animal cells into your muscle tissue, that's something your body's never seen before. That is not a natural way of introducing new substances into your body. Your body knows things that it eats. Mm-hmm. That's, you know, the way your antibodies develop. But so they weaken the virus because, of course, they don't want to give you the full virus. That would defeat the point. And so they weaken it, but they can't get an immune response from you because then it's not strong enough. So they do something, you know, so they add what they call an adjuvant, which increases your immune response, which is kind of my theory as to why people end up with autoimmune disorders after this and they don't make the connection to, that was the flu shot I had, or that was the DPT, or that was the MMR, or, you know, that was the chickenpox vaccine, or the Gardasil, or, you know, any number of these that are so numerous and plentiful. So there are even more that, I mean, if I read you the list, your jaw would just drop. But those are all available. That list of what's in a vaccine can actually be found on the FDA website. It's there for everyone to see. It's public domain. So if anyone wants to do the research on what exactly is, you know, in their vaccine, they can go and they can check. They can also check, you know, my Facebook and my social media accounts, because I've posted it all over the place to let people know. This is not necessarily what you think it is.
But there's they counter with that there's a lot of diseases that have been kind of we've defeated because of the vaccination process, you know, that they vaccinate kids in school. So now we no longer deal with certain things like, I don't know, smallpox or measles or, you know, stuff like that. You know, how would you explain that?
That is a great question. And that is one that a lot of people, of people ask. The reason is because it depends on which graph you're looking at, really. Because when I was, for example, one of the courses I took in medical school was called epidemiology. And when they taught epidemiology, which is basically the study of the statistics of disease and how much occurs and where it occurs and who it occurs, you know, so what disease happens to who and how much of it and how many people get it. I saw all kinds of graphs that showed that vaccines were literally introduced near the end of an infectious epidemic. Mm-hmm. So as people were developing their own natural herd immunity, which they do develop on their own when exposed to a disease like that, you don't need a vaccine to develop immunity. You get something, you develop your own. And people do develop that as a group without ever having vaccines. So they develop the herd immunity, and literally you'll see a bell-shaped curve. So you'll see an infectious disease peak. Mm-hmm. You always see it with an infectious disease. You always see it peak, and then you see it die down. And it looks literally like the shape of a bell. So they call it a bell-shaped curve. Mm-hmm. And so regardless of what happens, regardless of if a vaccine comes in or if it, you know, it never comes in, you're going to see an infectious epidemic peak, and you're going to see it fall down. So, and a lot of times, and I couldn't even believe that I was learning this in medical school, because they showed where the vaccines were introduced, and it was near the end of the bell-shaped curve. And so they just basically take credit for that last little bit of this thing going away. So it kind of depends, because now I've seen some other graphs of, you know, people saying, you know, oh, measles was, you know, completely wiped out, which is not true, because we have it now. And we have people that have been vaccinated, and we have a large number of people that have been vaccinated who still get it.
Oh, wow.
So the vaccination is not a, is not a, obviously in recent times, is not a perfect protection against, against that disease. And now there is also the issue of mutation.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's true.
Which viruses do, and they do every year. When we have a flu epidemic, near the end of the flu season, that virus has mutated. So when they give you the flu vaccine, what a lot of people, first of all, what a lot of people experience is they get the flu from the vaccine. About 10% or so of people will actually get flu-like symptoms from the vaccine. And the flu vaccine is actually developed in advance, and it has to be, because they have to test it, because let's remember that these are chemicals and things that have never you know, really existed before in nature. So they have to be tested to make sure that they don't kill people, which they do anyway, but they go, they have to go through a period of testing. They have to go through a period of culturing the virus. So it has to grow in a certain medium, and this takes some time. So it takes some time, and because it takes a lot of time to make a vaccine, they have to kind of know in advance what the virus is. So they make their best guess, and sometimes they get it, and sometimes that virus mutates and the vaccine is no good. And that's exactly what happened this year, is that vaccine came out, and literally they said, we're sorry, the virus is mutated, this year's vaccine is not effective.
Oh, and God.
The crazy thing that happened is absolutely crazy, is that some doctors were saying, well, you should have it anyway.
Oh, my God.
Why? The virus is mutated. It's no protection at all. It's just injecting yourself with, you know, mercury and the aluminum. And, oh, my goodness, they've done these studies in newborns that show their blood mercury levels go sky high when they're vaccinated. So it's these things, if it's not safe for a baby, really kind of, you know, you got to think about, if it's not safe for a baby, maybe it's not safe for me either.
Yeah, it's probably not great for you either. It's a very hot topic, and it's a touchy subject. A lot of people get really freaked out about it. So I'm glad that, you know, you're bringing it up in the conversation and giving us a little more depth of understanding what's going on and what's actually in these vaccines. And because you don't really hear about it. You hear about the, you know, oh, the irresponsible parent that's not vaccinating their child, but you don't hear about like the other kids that have gotten sick.
Right. That's... And I think where the panic comes from is that people don't know what else to do. They don't have an action plan, and they don't, they're not familiar with anything else that they could do. So, and I think it's why the medical profession pushes it so much, because they don't know what else to do. Right.
Right.
So you got to have an action plan. You got to know what works for you. You got to know what remedies, you know, work for this sort of thing. You got to kind of educate yourself, and you got to play around with those remedies, and you got to try them and experiment with them and know that they work. And then, you know, you kind of have to know the basics of natural healing to know what you can do. There's a lot you can do. There's a lot you could do for measles. You know, there's a lot you could do with just vitamin C. But, you know, aside from that, there's a lot you can do with echinacea, with garlic, with juice fasting, with blood cleansing herbs. You can, you know, clear rashes fairly quickly. I mean, these doctors, they have literally no idea what's possible. And so the way they're kind of approaching it is really a fear-based model of, oh my God, if they don't get a vaccine from us, they could die, you know, they could have all these horrible things happen. And of course, what we're seeing statistically is that more people are now being harmed by vaccines than the people that could have actually been saved by them. So we're kind of reaching like that critical point in history where people are saying, you know, just last night, I was reading a girl's history. She was only 23 years old. She received the Gardasil vaccine, and immediately she knew something was wrong. She felt something, you know, bad happening. She felt some kind of brain fog, confusion come in. She felt tingling all over her body. The next day, she literally woke up paralyzed from the neck down.
Oh my God.
Paralyzed from the neck down. She said she spent 2 years of her life trying to go to all of these doctors. And she says she's gotten a lot of function back because she went to the holistic doctors. But 23 years old, she's like, my life is never, you know, maybe never will be normal because I had this Gardasil vaccine. And it's only one of so many stories. If anybody wanted to research it, they would find many, many, many stories. Of course, with the flu vaccine, there is always that chance of something called Guillain-Barré syndrome. And it's well known, it's a well-documented, you know, side effect of the flu vaccine or any other sort of vaccine. So it behooves people to really, really do that research, because in Guillain-Barré syndrome, you start losing the feeling in your extremities. So it starts from the feet, and you can become paralyzed. So her case was a really severe one, but it does happen, and it's not so rare, because I actually knew someone in medical school, and she had Guillain-Barré syndrome.
Oh, my gosh.
So it's not as rare as you think it would be.
Yeah. You know? So you mentioned that you were familiar or, you know, experienced talking to people initially in that waiting room to see that holistic nurse about people that had autoimmune diseases, lupus. Mm-hmm. And I know I have friends that, you know, have received some recent diagnoses, and friends that had struggling with Graves' disease, and it seems to affect women a lot. And so if you could talk a little bit about why is this happening and how can people help themselves?
Okay. Something else that I also had during that horrible period was that I had an inflamed thyroid, which was overactive, and it looked like Graves' disease. So I did have a physical sort of explanation for that whole, you know, racing heartbeat. And in fact, I've developed a protocol just for Graves' disease, but there are many others. There's lupus, there's Sjogren's syndrome, there's something that's becoming even more more and more common nowadays, which is basically autoimmune disease not otherwise specified, or kind of just like this murky area where they don't know what to call it, so they just call it NOS, you know, unspecified, idiopathic. We're getting, you know, more and more of these diagnoses, which is basically they want to call it something so you take them seriously.
Right.
But it's basically a glorified Latin way of saying, we don't know.
Oh, my God. No,
we don't know why you have this.
Oh, geez.
So what can you do about it? There are herbs that you can take that are immune, what I call immune modulators. So the way we kind of learned about medicines is that they stimulate or they depress. And I like to really encourage people to think of herbs more as balancers. They modulate, they balance. Mm-hmm. So don't be afraid of taking immune system herbs. I've used echinacea in people with lupus. I've used, you know, immune system herbs in people with autoimmune. And it's fine. It's you know, this fear of herbs when you've got an autoimmune disease is based on people are trying to understand herbs the way they understand medicine.
Mm-hmm.
And medicine does not work like herbs at all. Basically, to make a medicine, this is so interesting because I just saw a documentary about Amazonian herbs, and they were saying that 25% of all the pharmaceuticals are actually originated from plants in the Amazon. But and it's much more than that. People don't realize that this is like a pet project of mine, seeing, you know, what pharmaceuticals came from what, you know, natural origin. But so they come from the natural plants, but then they change them drastically. Mm-hmm. And they do something that makes logical sense. They take what they think is the most active constituent and they extract it.
Okay. Uh-huh.
Right? And without realizing that those other nutrients and phytonutrients, mm-hmm. and phytoconstituents and all of the natural components of that herb or that plant are there for a reason. And right. they help balance and right. modulate that active principle.
Yeah.
So they take this out of context and mm-hmm. they concentrate it and they try to make it stronger. And they go, yes, this is so much better because we can get a big result really fast. Mm-hmm. And if you use an herb, you're going to get a slower effect at first, but you're going to get the healing and the detox that comes from it. And you're going to get a long-term sort of strengthening of your body. And you're going to get that hope of mm-hmm. what I read about in the Bernard Jensen books, which is that you could actually literally, you know, change your state of health instead of just managing your symptoms. Mm-hmm. You could be done with, you know, a lot of them, most of them, or even mm-hmm. all of them.
Gotcha.
So, so yes, what I recommend for autoimmune is to go through a lot of times. Yeah, it's not just immune system herbs. You go through the colon cleansing, you go through the liver cleansing, you do the detox, but these people also need hormonal support, which I'm seeing so much now, is that people have weak thyroid, they have weak adrenals, they're exhausted, mm-hmm. they're fatigued, chronic fatigue. It's becoming more and more common, multiple chemical sensitivity. And, you know, of course, you've got the autoimmune. So, of course, on the emotional side, an autoimmune disorder is something about not loving yourself, kind mm-hmm. of sabotaging yourself, because literally your body is attacking itself.
Right, right.
So, you know, you go through the physical healing and you should also go through an emotional healing as well.
Okay. Interesting. Huh. So it's actually, that's brought me back to my next question, is cleanses. So from what I, you know, glean from, you know, my conversations with you and something I've suspected even before, was that these cleanses are extremely important, crucial actually, mm-hmm. To healing. You know, one is getting ready, getting rid of the crap that's kind of layered up in your body and right, obstructing right. And weighing down your vital organs like liver and pancreas, mm-hmm. gallbladder, and two, just anything that you might take later, like let's say that you're taking some herbs and you're trying to get a result. If your colon is so obstructed, you're not going to be able to absorb properly and it's just going to go back into your bloodstream and you just have more symptoms mm-hmm. from the improper absorption of whatever remedy you're taking. And I think I learned that from your site. I'm parroting it back to you now.
Yes, wonderful. Okay, so this is interesting because the medical perspective on the whole thing is this colon cleansing is ridiculous. It's not going to help you with anything. It's a waste of money. It's a waste of time. We do colonoscopies and we don't see anything in there. Mm-hmm. But when you do it, and also they say things like, it's okay if you only go to the bathroom once a week, as long as it's once every week and as long as it's regular,
This
is the way I was trained. And of course I've gone way past that because, I've done, you know, so much colon cleansing, that colon cleansing is absolutely the foundation of what I do because what happens and what I've seen, and this is so interesting, and why I do the formulas, the herbal formulas mm-hmm. that I use, and encourage people to do a little juice fasting with it, because I had done all these coffee enemas, I had done the colonics, they were great, they pulled a lot of toxins out. I started taking the formulas that I use now, and I literally passed what's called a mucoid plaque layer.
Ew.
After a year and a half of doing some pretty serious, you know, colon cleansing, It literally comes out in like this big, huge chunk. It looks like it's in the shape of your intestines.
It's like a snake shedding or something. That's what it sounds like. This whole like.
Yes. Yes. It's, you notice this is going on. It's like the bowel movement that doesn't end, right? It's kind of funny. But after you pass it, your health jumps up a level. People's symptoms can sometimes go away. Rashes can clear up. All kinds of things can happen after this plaque. So we're not just passing a plaque layer like, oh, that was in there. Maybe it was something in the herbs. No, there's no mucus. There's no mucus in your herbs, right? I don't know why the doctors don't see anything on colonoscopy, but people do pass this and they do have dramatic jumps in their health if they do it. It's more likely to happen if you do some juice fasting, you don't eat much, you let the herbs do their work. You can sometimes pass parasites during this type of cleanse. I've had people, you know, just calling me up in a panic going, past parts of my intestines have come out. And am I okay? You know, and I just reassure them, yes, it's okay. It's your intestines are still in there. That's just, you know, a mucus layer. Your colon secretes mucus. Every time you put something wrong in there, your colon's going to secrete mucus. What happens to mucus, really?
Yeah,
I mean, it dries up or it hardens, basically. If you were just to leave it alone, it dries up and it hardens. So that's what it does. It dries, it hardens, it compacts, you know, layers upon layers of mucus. You know, we are eating that standard American diet, all kinds of processed foods, chemicals, preservatives, coal tar based, you know, flavors and colorings and FD&C red number 6 and, you know, tartrazine, yellow dye number 5, all kinds of horrible things we're putting in our mouths. And it's going into the colon. The colon's just going, oh, this is a disaster. Mm-hmm. It's a protective response. Your body tries to protect itself against this stuff. It's like, put some mucus out there.
You know? Oh, gosh. Yeah. So. But that can, you know, also end up being kind of a problem unto itself, right? When you become like, because I know I've been struggling with sinus issues off and on, and you know, and I'm like, get rid of this mucus finally. So does it just meaning like I'm overloaded with mucus and now it's going anywhere it can, like, or is it a result of inflammation?
It's often, you know, something that's tracked back to the bowel. So we don't just have problems with mucus, but we also have problems with chronic constipation. And sometimes people, even if they go once a day, can develop something later in life that's called diverticulosis, diverticulitis, those sort of, you know, outpouchings that are due to pretty much 20 years of not going to the bathroom enough. And so it creates extra pressure in the bowel. And so if you notice, sometimes if you were to blow up a balloon and there was a weak spot in the balloon, you would see that there's like an extra area that makes an extra pouch. So this is what happens in your colon. You get these extra pouches and then things collect in there.
Oh.
And then even though you're going to the bathroom every day, the stuff that's collected in those pouches just stays there. And it will start to ferment and rot and everything else that happens when you, you know, if you were to leave food on your counter for a week, what would happen to it? You know, you'd have
rotted food.
You know, it'd start to liquefy and stink and smell and everything else. And so the same thing kind of happens in your colon. If you're only going once a week or whatever, and you've got these pouches and you'll literally, you know, see people that have body odor that don't really understand why it's happening, but also other things. For example, if your colon's not eliminating as many toxins as, you know, if it's not functioning optimally and you're overloaded, your body will literally create a second way to get that stuff out. So sometimes it's a wound that drains and drains and drains, and no matter what you do, no matter what you put on it, it drains. It's like your body's just fighting to get that toxic stuff out, and it can't get out through the colon because you're just not going to the bathroom enough. And there's all that stuff stuck in the pouches or the mucus, layer upon toxin upon layer upon toxin, and it's all, you know, in there. And Why is it important? Because your colon is designed to absorb water. And so there's all these blood vessels that take whatever's in your colon and just, you know, take it to the liver and going through the lymphatics. And so your colon is connected to everything. And so if your colon's in bad shape, your whole body is going to be in bad shape.
Right.
Just because of the way everything's connected. So you'll see weeping wounds, you'll see discharges, you'll see, you know, all kinds of, you know, sinus discharge and things like that. And a lot of times it traces back to that.
To the colon.
And then, yeah. And then sometimes it's just air pollution, you know.
Yeah.
Just from living in a big city, you know.
A lot of smog. And, mm-hmm.
A lot of problems with their sinuses. So there are all those. I've had people that did a liver cleanse that it made a big difference for them.
Oh, yeah, I can imagine.
I've had people with anaphylactic allergic reactions do liver cleanses, and they can lose some of their allergies that way.
Oh, wow. I just wanted to inject right here really quick, just for everybody listening, if this sounds really interesting to you, you know, of course, you can contact Dr. Cynthia Foster directly, or you can join. We've teamed up and we're going to launch a coaching program also with an Ayurvedic practitioner, doctor, friend of mine, for a 3-month coaching program where you're going to get all these consultations and we personally handhold you through establishing your body type, what proper food and exercise is good for you. Dr. Foster is going to also consult with you and give you a kind of lead you through a series of cleanses or kind of consult with you, let you know where you're at and physically and what you need. Mm-hmm. So yeah, anyway, you'll get more information about this, I promise, or send me an email and I will let you know. But I wanted to just quickly ask you, I know that we're almost reaching the end of the hour, but I know that you just let me know that you have discovered the Merck index.
Yes.
From 1907, I believe. Would you tell us a little bit more about that? I found that fascinating.
Merck is, of course, we know of them as Merck Sharp and Dohme. They are one of the largest pharmaceutical companies in the world. I think mm-hmm. the last statistics show that they were the 7th largest pharmaceutical company in the world. Merck actually started as a German company. In 1665, they supplied chemicals and herbs. So as the one of the Merck relatives actually came to New York and established something called E. Merck, and they published the first Merck index in 1886 or 1896, and their first Merck index was just literally an order form. So mm-hmm. I actually got a 5th edition from 1930 because I thought that would give a good indication of the herbs that mm-hmm. they had listed. But that index actually was altered because at that point, chemical medicines were starting to be released and to the public, and these things were being patented, and there was a lot of money to be made off of this. So financially speaking, it was a lot more profitable to sell those pharmaceutical drugs because they were patented than mm-hmm. it was to sell the herbal remedies. But when I got to the 3rd index, this is where I found all the juicy stuff, the really great stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, I looked up hydrangea. And in the 5th edition, it says, well, there's no evidence for this. But in the 3rd edition, it says, this is used for dropsy. This is used for lithiasis. They will, you know, write out all the technical medical terms. Lithiasis mm-hmm. are stones. So gallstones, kidney stones, they use that. Of course, that's in my stone dissolving remedy. So the gravel root, the hydrangea, and those are all listed in the 3rd index from 1907, which was basically when there were all those natural medical schools that existed in the country before they were wiped out by the people that had more money, the multi-millionaire yeah. conglomerates.
Oh my goodness. Okay. It sounds amazing. Are you going to kind of give, you know, put on some information on your site
will be, yes.
Okay, so we can...
I'm going to take full advantage of that, yes.
Oh,
it's amazing that, you know, this pharmaceutical company, they had you know, all of this great technical knowledge at the time that was used and was successfully used by people. Mm-hmm. And it just got phased out because it was not profitable.
Not profitable. Yeah.
There's so much information back there. I'm really discovering, you know, there's more than you could possibly ever, you know, use. I could fill up your entire day with natural remedies and things like that, and we'd only be scratching the surface.
Oh, gosh. It sounds fascinating. I love this stuff, by the way. To me, it's also incredibly fascinating. And I can't wait for it. I'm already studying your site, as you can tell.
There's hidden areas, too. I just posted a really in-depth article on vaccines and what the statistics show about them. It's like a 6-page interview. So,
oh, wow.
you can find that. I'll send you a link.
Okay, please do. And is there a book that you recommend for people that want to kind of delve a little deeper into the subject or continue the conversation?
I am working on getting Stop the Medicine reprinted. Mm-hmm. That's a really great one. It's very inspiring. It's a good place to start. It kind of you know, walks you through that. You know, why do you want to challenge what your doctor thinks? Mm-hmm. And after that, you know, really come to my website because I've got it spelled out. And if you join my mailing list, I'm going to teach you. Mm-hmm. I'm going to teach you a lot of those things. So
fabulous. What's how do we find you? What's the address of the website?
I'm going to give you two because the easy one is doherbs.com.
And how do you spell that?
Just, you know, instead of doing drugs, you do herbs.
Oh, do herbs. Okay.
Right. And so that's the easy one. And the long one is Dr. Foster's essentials.com.
Great. I will post all those links and the book link and everything on the show notes page for Dr. Cynthia Foster. So please just go to adventuresinspiritandentrepreneurship.com and look for Cynthia, and you will find all that information laid out, plus any amazing excerpts from the interview that you will find too. I will post that as well. Dr. Cynthia, thank you so, so much. This was so amazing and so eye-opening, and I think it gives a lot of hope for people. I think people can listen to this and feel inspired, like, oh, okay, so I'm not stuck just taking medications, like drugging myself for the rest of my days with a, you know, so said incurable disorder.
There is an answer. Some time. Yeah, if you take some time and you learn those things and you do a little research, you will find your whole life is going to change. Mm-hmm. It literally can change you.
Yeah, amazing.
Thank you so much. This was a really great interview. I'm very excited to get this message out and to have people's lives change for the better and to have people, you know, starting to get well and come out of their sicknesses.
Oh, me too. Me too. Great information. Thank you. Thank you again. And and we will be, the two of us will be together again for the coaching. So I'll keep you posted. Thank you, Dr. Cynthia.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for listening to today's podcast. For more details, including my own personal reflections of today's interview, please visit adventuresinspiritandentrepreneurship.com. To receive my free gift of the 12 best ways to shift your mindset and improve your mood and career, please subscribe to my list on my site. I also appreciate your support of my podcast by subscribing on iTunes and giving me a rating and a review, as well as any feedback or suggestions on how I may serve you better and provide the information you want to hear.